Hey guys, Mike here from Envy Creative. So over the weekend, the YouTuber Chris Howe came out with a video about his Synology setup. And if you're not sure what Synology is, it's a NAS server or a remote attached storage server. And basically, instead of storing stuff on an external hard drive, you would store it on a NAS server, which gives you a lot more protection, a lot more features, and a lot more security when it comes to your files. But anyway, Chris made a YouTube video about their new Synology setup, and he admits that he's a noob when it comes to all of this. But here at Envy, we've been using Synology servers for about 10 years, both for our normal post-production workflow, as well as all of our backups. And so after watching his video, because he admits that he's a little bit of a noob, we just wanted to touch on a few things that he said, because from our experience, there are a couple things that you want to do different, just for the sake of keeping your backup safe, as well as some workflows that are a little bit easier than what he described. Now, I do love Chris Howe. I love what he's doing and I love all the content he puts out there. But again, we've been using Synology servers for a long time, so we have a lot of experience when it comes to workflows and other technical things that he may not know about yet. But when it comes to backing up files, you really should have two physical backups and one backup in the cloud offsite. And that's called the rule of three when it comes to backing up files, whether in the server world or in the backup software world. Now, Chris mentions that they went a little bit overboard when it comes to their backup setup, but I'm guessing that here at Envy Creative, we go a little bit even more overboard. But again, that's just to make sure that everything's backed up so that we never lose a piece of data or a file. So what we do here is we take our memory card, we put it in the computer, and we offload it directly to the Synology server. And that Synology server is our working server, so that's what we edit off of, and that's what we do all of our work off of. And that's a bigger 6-bay server, so it can hold up to 6 hard drives. However, we have it set up for a working server, so we actually have 4 of the hard drives that are for storage, and 2 of the hard drives are ultra-fast SSD hard drives, so that it creates a cache so that we can access things off the server even quicker, so that when we're editing, we don't get any lag, and we can access everything off there in real time. From there, we have a smaller Synology server on-site that's only a 2-bay server, so we just put really, really high-capacity hard drives in there, and that does a mirror from our working server, so everything is getting backed up every day on there. Now, one of the reasons having an on-site backup is really important compared to what Chris was saying. For instance, if our Synology server just died, maybe the motherboard died or the RAM went out, then we actually have an on-site server so that we can pick up from where we left off right then and there, rather than needing to recover it from, say, an off-site Synology server. And then what we have is we have another 4-bay Synology server at my house that's actually our archive server. And what I mean by archive is it's not a working server. We don't work off of it. Whenever we're done with a project, we put it on that server just for archival in case we ever need to access it later. We work with Final Cut Pro, so there is a specific way of preparing Final Cut libraries for archive that deletes all the render and proxy footage, so you're really only left with the timeline as well as the original footage only, and it really compresses the library so that you can zip the whole file and store it for archive. So, up till now, you know that we have our working Synology server here, we have a backup Synology server on site, and then we have a remote Synology server just for archives. So that's 3 physical servers that have all of our data on it, but we wanted to take it one step further. Because we're in Southern California, there are earthquakes here, and my house is actually pretty close by to the studio, so in case anything were to happen to, say, the studio and my house, then we want to make sure we have cloud backups of both our working server and our archive server. So for this, we actually use a program called Crash Plan that gives you unlimited backup storage for only $10 per device per month. So we only pay $20 a month to back up both our on-site server and our remote archive server. The one thing with Crash Plan to be able to back up a network attached storage is it only works with Macs. So we actually just bought 2 used Mac Minis so that we could mount the server on that Mac Mini to run Crash Plan on so that it could just back up that way. So with all of that put together, there are multiple things that can fail that we still wouldn't lose any of our data. So one of the main benefits of having an on-site server that you're actually working off of is that you can actually offload, say, your footage to the server directly from your computer rather than just plugging in a hard drive and transferring it that way, like Chris said he was doing, so that you can have peace of mind knowing that your footage is backed up in triplicate and nothing's gonna happen to it. Now, I do know that he said that his editor works from home, and actually our head of post-production currently works from home most days of the week too, so he works off of a hard drive as well, but after our shoot days, what he does is he actually offloads the footage both to his hard drive and the NAS server as well, so it's being backed up to two places at once. And the way we easily do this is we use an offloading program specifically for footage called Hedge. Now, for the longest time, we have done the simple drag and drop method, but I would say about 3% of the time, there would be some sort of error where something wouldn't copy or there would be some sort of blip, even though we thought it all copied okay. So one of the benefits to using a program like Hedge is it actually checks the checksum as well. So that means it pretty much triple checks that it's copying every single piece of data over to wherever your destination is. One of the other benefits of using Hedge rather than dragging and dropping is you can do multiple destinations at the same time. So rather than dragging to two places, which might not be that fast, you can actually set two destinations, drag it in, and it'll transfer to both of those destinations pretty quickly, a lot faster than just dragging and dropping it. So again, since our head of post works from home, once we dump the footage from the shoot day and he takes his hard drive home, we've actually set him up with another large capacity hard drive to use as a time machine on his computer at home so that it's not only backing up his personal computer, but it's also backing up that external hard drive from Envy. So again, even if that hard drive dies, he still has a backup of all the project files just in case he needs to recover those. And from Chris's video, it sounds like they offload them on one drive and work on that drive, which isn't super safe because if that hard drive dies and you don't have a backup, then you're kind of out of luck. He didn't mention anything like backing up that hard drive as well, but in case he's not, that's probably a good idea to get a backup hard drive for that hard drive as well. Another thing that he said in the video is that he has another Synology NAS offsite at his editor's house, and it actually mirrors from his onsite Synology NAS so that he has a remote backup. Now, while this is great in theory, again, we've been using Synology servers for a long time, and we've tried doing that, but for some reason, it's really, really slow, and sometimes there are hiccups. And again, if something goes wrong on the Synology server onsite, and it hasn't backed up all the way because, again, it's not that fast, then again, you're gonna lose whatever files or information you had that hasn't made the jump to the offsite server yet. Now, even though we love our Synology servers, the remote transfer software, like I said, isn't that fast. Now, Chris mentions using Dropbox that they used to use as a backup, and that's actually the better idea for transferring from an onsite Synology server to an offsite server. So Synology has this program called Cloud Sync, which lets you connect Dropbox, Google Drive, or any other cloud storage platforms directly to your Synology so that it can back up whatever you want to the cloud. You can even set it to back up your entire server to the cloud. Now, we personally use Google Drive, so that's a great option if you want to have the entire server mirrored on another server. So you're actually getting the speed of a service like Dropbox or Google Drive that's actually faster than the Synology service that backs up directly to an offsite server. But you're also getting that middle layer of backup protection. So when it backs up from the on-site server to Google Drive or Dropbox, you're getting that backup, and then you can actually set up your off-site server to also sync with Google Drive or Dropbox. So when it backs up here, it's actually syncing with that Google Drive or Dropbox. So essentially it is doing the same thing. It's mirroring from your on-site to your off-site, just with an intermediary in between for a safety net and for the speed. Now, what we actually do, because we use our offsite server as an archive server, we prep the project folders here on our working server, and then we zip them and just put them into a single folder on our Synology NAS that syncs with our offsite server. So on our offsite server, we can just grab it and put it in for cold storage. All right, and the one other thing I have to address is the folder structure that Chris came up with. Now, I know that everybody has their own file folder structure that they use on their projects and their servers and their hard drives. But when I saw his, I felt like a lot of the stuff could be consolidated into other folders like we do here at Envy. So this is what Chris's file structure looks like. As you can see, things like photos get their own folder, things like exports get their own folder, things like footage get their own folder, and that's great, but here at Envy, we've done over 3,000 projects. So over the years, we've really honed and we've really, I think, perfected the file structure that we use to make it as easy as possible and as streamlined as possible to find everything. So here's what our server folder structure looks like. Right at the top, you can see all our folders in dates, and those are actually automatic folders that Hedge makes when it imports all of our footage. It makes a folder for the date, and then any card that we offload that day, it just puts a new folder inside of that folder. So we have all of our footage up top so that we can reference it really quickly based on the date on the call sheet, so we can look up projects that way if we need to get to certain footage. And then we usually have two kinds of videos that we do. We do commercial videos as well as product videos, and all copies of footage, exports, and photos go within each project folder. And we make it really simple so that we can easily find what we need via search, or we can usually just find it by looking. So for our folder structure, first we have the project type, followed by the client, followed by their invoice number, and then followed by a quick title of what the project is or the product. This way, we have multiple ways that we can search for a project. We can either search by the client, we can search by the invoice number, we can search by the name of the project, or in general, we can search by the type of project. We also have a couple of other miscellaneous folders, for instance, our assets folder, where we keep a lot of our music, our effects, and a lot of our other assets that we use in our videos, as well as some other folders that we have to use for specific instances or for specific services. I know this was a lot of information to throw at you guys, but again, Chris just started with his Synology server. And like I said, we've been using Synology servers for 10 years now. So we've gone through a lot of the hiccups and a lot of trial and error that we made along the way to make a system that we think is super foolproof and that we haven't lost any data yet since we started that, as well as some of the other things regarding file structure and remote syncing. And if you got value from this video, if you could just tap the like button, it really helps us out to make sure our video gets seen by more people so that more people can learn about all the topics that we have to cover. Thanks so much, guys, for watching. And if you have any questions about anything that I said here today, feel free to leave a comment and I'll be sure to answer any questions you guys have, because again, I know that it was a lot of information, and we'll catch you on the next one.